Hey, Flowcasting has previously been described as the holy grail of demand-driven supply chain planning. The process was first published back in 2006 and works on the basis that by knowing every single product movement in a retail supply chain, the only place you need to forecast is at the point of sales. Today on LokadTV, we're going to learn a little bit more about this technique and discuss whether it's still relevant today. So Johannes, perhaps we should start just by explaining a little bit more about what Flowcasting actually is and how it actually works.
Okay, so Flowcasting was a term coined with the publication of the book, you know, in 2006. The book is also called Flowcasting. It's a technique that is dedicated to retail networks. So it's like supply chain optimization for retail networks. And this book comes with tons of very, very interesting insights. And it's a whole recipe on how to do it. And simply put, the intuition is that pick every single product at every single location, forecast every single day ahead, and ideally with very, very accurate forecast. And then you will get, you know, a full picture of everything that is going to happen that are driven by your I would say, your client sales, what is very close to the demand. And from that, the idea is that you can reconstruct all the supply chain decisions that you need to take by just, you know, taking those super disaggregated forecasts that are, you know, at the product level, per location, daily, and just re-aggregating this data. And then you can reconstruct all the supply chain decisions that you need to take by just walking backward from those forecasts. Backward, I mean, from the store back to the warehouse, back to the suppliers.
Okay, so what was so different about this vision? How did it sort of differ from some of the techniques that were around at the time?
So that, where it kind of differs is that it had, I would say, a whole series of very acute insights. The importance of being as close as possible to the demand. It's not like they discovered that, it was already kind of known, but to my, I would say, to my knowledge, it was maybe one of the first books that really acknowledged first that you need to be super close to what is the best demand signal that you have, which is just your sales at the very end of the chain, which differs, you know, in many supply chains when they have multiple echelons. Typically, one echelon is only looking at what is happening on the next echelon. So basically, if you're the supplier, you look at what is happening in the warehouse that purchased from you, but as a supplier, you never looked at what is happening in the stores or et cetera, et cetera. So that's, in this respect, they were probably not the first, but it was very coherent. You have to be very, very close to the demand signal. And then there is value in looking at the thing at the basically the most disaggregated level, which is product per store, instead of just saying we are just going to re-aggregate everything per week, per product, just because numerically it's easier to process.
So what do you mean by disaggregated? Are we really sort of talking about breaking this down to every single individual SKU level in every single store?
Exactly. I mean, that's also, you know, something that Flowcasting suggests, which is also very different from most of the techniques of the time, where typically people were expecting to do like top-down forecasts, where you forecast by categories and you split it by subcategories. Then you're going to split that by maybe regions and whatnot. And at the very, very end, you will have maybe a couple of clusters of typical stores and say, well, if I have store type A, type B, type C, I'm just going to allocate based on the store profile, etc. But basically you avoid dealing with the most disaggregated stage, which is every single product at every single location, where the amount of data just explode.
Okay, so why are we actually talking about this kind of today? I mean, surely there's other more modern techniques that have replaced this. Why is it something that's relevant?
So first, it's very interesting because 10 years ago, it was all rage, literally. And I've seen in, I would say, at least half a dozen of large retail network that were kind of got very, very interested into the insights of Flowcasting. And what was very interesting was that it never worked. So it was like a book full of seemingly very good ideas. And then when people tried to put that in production, it just didn't work. And not like it was not good enough. It didn't work at all. And it was like brutally non-functional to a point that was completely unexpected. Because when you read the book, it's like very simple ideas. They give you very simple recipes. And it looks like, well, we could just do it. With those, you know, daily forecasts and everything, and giving some simple recipes to produce those forecasts and to leverage them afterward for supply chain decisions. And it turned out that it literally, when you try to put that in practice, it violently do not work. And it's very surprising in a way. And so there's kind of many insights to be taken. So which are, why did it not work? And why I believe that the reason why Flowcasting was brutally not working is because you need some further insights, which are very counterintuitive and that are still, I would say, very far from being well known today. So you see, Flowcasting failed because they missed some super critical stuff. But the interesting thing is that most of the market and most of the actors are still missing those insights as well. So yes, Flowcasting has gone out of fashion after a decade, but the very reason why it did fail, those root causes behind the failures are still not well known, which means that the next, unless many actors kind of upgrade their understanding, they will just face the very, very same problems.
Okay, so it seems kind of fairly logical. I mean, on the surface of it, you're looking at a point of sales, you're forecasting there, and it's flowing back throughout your whole supply chain. Kind of makes sense logically. Yes. So where does it all fall apart then?
It falls apart because of stochasticity, because of the uncertainty.
Stochasticity?
What do you mean there? It's the phenomenons that are not deterministic, where you have an inherent degree of randomness in them. And sales at the store level are highly erratic, highly random. It's, yes, you might be selling about one unit a week, but you will never know which day of the week, you know. And if you produce a forecast where you try, so you have two ways to do it. If you want to read like the classical perspective, either, okay, I'm selling one unit a week. I'm going to put the unit on the first day of the week and then put all the other days at zeros. Well, that will give you very weird artifacts if you do that, because then the first day of the week, you end up with a massive surge of demand coming from all those products where you say, well, the one unit a week falls on the first day of the week. Or you can do like fractional demand. Yes, I'm selling like 0.15 units a day. But what does that mean? You know, if you're selling like a fraction of an integer, do I need to ship one more unit to store? Yes or no? It doesn't really make sense, because in supply chain decisions, you know, it has to be integers. Either you ship one unit more or you don't. The fact that you have like 0.15 unit of demand, what do you do with that? It's like it's not a real thing. I mean, there is no such thing as like fractional thing. People cannot, I would say, take away a fraction of a bottle of Coke. It's like you take the whole bottle or not. So bottom line, at the very core of the Flowcasting, which is like forecasting the flow, they had this idea that you will rely on a deterministic forecast where you can say with like perfect accuracy, you are going to sell 2 days from now exactly one bottle of shampoo for this reference. And that's where actually everything falls apart. Those forecasts, they have nowhere to reflect any kind of uncertainty. And that's where actually forecasting just completely falls apart, is that uncertainty is absent. And thus, because uncertainty is absent, because you assume that your forecasts are accurate, not only your forecast just very, very badly reflects the future because they are not probabilistic forecasts, but then when it comes to the supply chain optimization, you act as if your forecasts are pretty much correct. And so you ignore all the, what we call at Lokad, the economic drivers that are balancing all those risks. So basically it's like you have a problem that is ignoring the uncertainty. And then as a consequence, which gets back to you with a vengeance, you also ignore the economic drivers that are completely central to optimize under uncertainty.
Okay, so if there were so many problems with this kind of approach, what actually happened then when retailers went to actually implement it? Were there any sort of widespread disasters that we sort of occurred?
I don't know. I mean, the retail's networks that I was in touch with, they never really got past, I would say, the prototype stage. So they were cautious. They tried it very, very small scale, but actually the numbers that was coming were so nonsensical that basically supply chain practitioners were saying, well, no, we can't just push that to the store. It's way too less, way too few, or way too much. You know, it was literally not making sense. So I don't think, at least to my knowledge, no large-scale retail network went into, I would say, even a prototype stage that was more than just a few dozens of products in a few stores or something, you know, very, very small scale, and terminated very quickly because it was, again, brutally dysfunctioning.
Okay, so it can't all be bad then. I mean, Flowcasting was a fairly well-known technique, had a fairly good reputation. So what's some of the good insights that were sort of given to us?
So there were a series of very, very interesting insights. So we just mentioned that you had to get as close as possible to the demand. And actually, they were saying that the most disaggregated level is per store, per product. I agree with the idea that you need to be as disaggregated as possible, but I do disagree with the fact that per product, per store is the most disaggregated level. The most disaggregated level is directly every single unit sold to every single customers. And because nowadays you have, I mean, most retail networks have, through loyalty programs, client tracking. So you know not only that you've sold this product in this location this day, but you know also to who you've sold this product. So you should not think as just time series, as they were describing in Flowcasting, but as time graph, where you know exactly who are the people you're selling to. That's a signal that contains even more information. But the key insight of Flowcasting about getting, you know, at the most disaggregated level is actually very profoundly correct. Another way that they really got right was the idea of having, like, automate everything with daily refresh of everything. That's exactly what Lokad suggests still nowadays. And indeed, if you do not have complete automations from you get the data from last day and you crunch it and you refresh everything, all your forecasts, all your decisions based off your forecast, then basically you're leaving a lot of money on the table just because, well, you are trying to solve a problem that is harder than it should be, just because you have like old data. If you have like the data from last week, it means that you're trying to forecast the sales of yesterday, but you don't need to forecast the sales of yesterday. You already know them. So you see that's why having those daily refresh is a very good, you know, practice, because otherwise you end up doing like, I'm using the data from last week to predict the what happened yesterday, which is completely nonsensical. So that's another very, very good insight from Flowcasting. Another good insight from Flowcasting, so that's what they call synchronicity. Another very good insight is that the idea that supply chain, it's kind of you need to have like a holistic vision across your echelons. And indeed, that's, by the way, what we did what we discussed in a previous episode about, you know, Bridgestone case, is that if you want to optimize your supply chain, you need to have some things that look at the whole network and all the flows that flows from the end customer demand back to the production. And if you do not have this kind of holistic perspective on the whole network, then basically you're just displacing problems instead of solving them. So again, Flowcasting had this very, very correct insight that you need to embrace the network as a whole instead of doing like stage optimization. We say, I'm going to optimize the warehouse without taking into account, you know, anything but the warehouse. And then you repeat the process independently for stores, for the warehouse, for maybe some buffers on the supplier side, et cetera, et cetera.
So what you're actually saying is that with Flowcasting, there was quite a few sort of valuable insights that actually we sort of share here at Lokad.
Yes.
So what are the sort of the key differences between that Flowcasting approach and what we do here at Lokad? And what are the things that we do very, very, very much better in your eyes?
So one of the key tenets of Flowcasting was that it can be made extremely simple, you know, extremely simple, like Excel simple, and that you can have all those forecasts and with very simple formulas, you can combine that, et cetera, et cetera. Obviously, simplicity is very good. Whenever you can achieve something that is simpler, it's very good. It's typically not easy to end up with something simple. On the contrary, simplicity is very hard to achieve. What you get by default is truckload of accident or complexity. But you have to make sure when you model a complex system, supply chains are a complex system, that your model is not simplistic. So you don't betray the realities that you're trying to model by having something that is less like a very, very naive mathematical representation of a reality that is not so simple. And I think, so what we do different is that we have tried to really embrace the fact that the reality in supply chain is very messy and downright frequently complicated. So that means that uncertainty is here to stay. If you say, oh, we just need forecasts that are just, you know, accurate, that's kind of a wishful thinking. There is like irreducible amount of uncertainty that is going on. So you need to have a system that just embraces the fact that uncertainty is here to stay. You end up with a probabilistic algebra. Suddenly it's a lot more complicated, but guess what? It's what it takes. Otherwise your results are nonsensical. Then you need to, if you want to extract, you know, as much information as you can from things like the most disaggregated level, which are the time graph of even clients, who is buying which product, where and when, then suddenly you can't, you know, extract information, all the information that you should be extracting for this data with just 9 time series. Yeah, it's a time graph. It's way more complicated. But guess what? You have a lot more information in this time graph. So that's what you want to leverage. So maybe another, you see, our perspective is instead of trying to sell simplicity, you want to have a system that is as simple as possible, but never simpler than what reality actually requires. And then I could go on and on, you know, with the fact that you have plenty of edge cases, nasty edge cases in supply chains. Your warehouse is shipping packs of bottles to the stores, but in the stores, it's actually individual bottles that get sold because sometimes the clients, they unpack the bottles. I mean, you have plenty of situations where, and maybe some clients, they really want to buy a pack of bottles. So you cannot just say, I'm just going to count the bottles and this is it. Sometimes you have clients that are very picky and say, well, if there is not a pack of bottles, a pack of 6 bottles, it's not practical, I'm going to buy it elsewhere. So that's all those sort of things that are very tricky. And I'm afraid that you can't expect to have like a simple silver bullet to approach that. So Lokad, because we realized that there was no silver bullet, we decided to have, let's have a tool, you know, Envision is programming language, to make it as simple as possible, but ideally without betraying the reality too much. I say too much because the reality, supply chains is really, really complex. You can just, you know, have a better approximation. You will never have the real thing modeled in your system.
Okay, so basically if Flowcasting had some of that probabilistic algebra behind it, it might have worked a bit better in the past, but it was in some ways probably 10 years before its time, 10
exactly.
years before the technology came about.
I think kind of 10 years before its time, where you had all the technological ingredient that could be put together so that you can actually execute what is still a relatively bold vision of supply chain.
Okay, and how about the Flowcasting of 2019? Is there something that looks very good on the surface, but actually when you get underneath it, it doesn't perform actually so well?
So what will be, you know, the next thing that is just like Flowcasting that looks super good, but that just going to falls apart? I believe that most of what is being sold under AI is going to fall apart. I'm not saying that, you know, deep learning or even the descendant of deep learning, differentiable programming, those are not excellent ingredients. They are excellent ingredients. But if all you have is the buzzword and just raw tech coming from domains such as image recognition that are not, I would say, directly applicable to supply chain, then I think many companies are just going to realize that raw tech, even if it's very impressive and can win against the Go champion, does not happen to magically solve their supply chain problems. And I would say, I suspect that 10 years from now, it will be AI will be even worse than Flowcasting. Flowcasting, 10 years down the road, I can still say there was some pretty good insight in this book. Even in the end, nothing was actually working with the recipes that those people describe. AI, I would say that probably 90% of what the vendors are pushing nowadays, there will be 10 years from now, for supply chain purposes, there will be exactly nothing that is worth, you know, reinvestigating, reconsidering. So it will be just like a pure, this thing will have gone, you know, to pure oblivion. Again, I'm distinguishing AI buzzword, which is, I think, you know, just a buzzword, from some fundamental algorithmic technique, deep learning, differentiable programming, that can be made very, very useful if very carefully aligned with the challenges of your supply chain.
Okay, it's definitely very surprising because it's definitely kind of the buzzword in the industry at the minute. To sort of conclude and sort of wrap things up, is Flowcasting still relevant? Is it still worth giving the book a read? I mean, what's the key message to learn from today?
I think this book is still worth a read. I mean, it's a pleasant read. I mean, the style is nice. It can be read, you know, you can read it literally maybe in a bit more than a few hours, but it's a very fast read. And I think many of the insights are still correct. What is completely incorrect is just the math that they just illustrate through the book. Apparently, the authors were not, I would say, they were not mathematicians, not statisticians, and it kind of show. But if you just put aside the math, say, well, those are just not the formulas that I need, in many of the insights, there were clearly people who had been giving some serious thoughts about supply chain in retail and the consequence of that and how you should rethink many, many angles at the core. And that's where I believe that the book really shined, is that many of those insights that they pointed out, you know, 10 years ago, they are still very correct and they are still vastly underexploited. You know, that means that those large retail networks are still not, you know, capturing most of those insights that were described in this Flowcasting book.
Okay, great. Well, we've run out of time for today, but thanks for your time. So that's everything for this week. Thanks very much for tuning in, and we'll see you again next time. Bye for now.